I greet you in the name of God, Creator, love incarnate, and Spirit of life. May hope, peace, joy, and love be with you this night. Welcome to our service. The carols will be unannounced. Simply, they're printed on the screen, but they're also in the hymn book, and you can follow along in your bulletin or the hymn boards. And please note that our call to worship and the lighting of the candles is an antiphonal reading, and when it says left, it means the folks on the left of the church. When it says right, it's the folks on the right of the church. Come, let us worship.
The people walking in darkness have seen a great light.
On those living in the pitch dark land, light has dawned. For a child is born to us, a son is given to us, and authority will be on his shoulders.
And he will be called
Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Eternal Father, Prince of Peace.
Oh,
Let us pray together. Gracious God, holy God, as we walk in the shoes of our everyday lives, we carry trembling hopes for the future. We prepare a place for the Christ to be born among us. May our own trembling hopes be enough to create a home for hope, peace, joy, and love. Help us to name these hopes and see each one as part of the birthing place of the Christ. May we add to the hope within the earth, which waits to receive its Christ. Thank you for reminding us that each small commitment to good, which is ours, is like a straw, a piece of wood, or a source of nurture for the Holy Child. Amen.
The greatest gift has been given, Jesus, our Emmanuel. Let us respond. Let us receive our gifts.
Singing thy praises only.
as they offered gifts most rare at that manger crude and bare, so may we with holy joy, pure and free from sin's alloy, all our costliest treasures bring, Christ to you, our heavenly King. Amen.
The first lesson this evening is from the Gospel according to St. Luke, chapter 2, verses 1 to 7, reading from a New Revised Standard Version. The birth of Jesus. In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David, called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver the child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. Amen. Continuing the story from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 2, verses 8 to 20. The shepherds and the angels. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flocks by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy to all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go now to Bethlehem and see this thing which has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. And when they saw this, they made known what had been told them about the child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. And then the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all that they had heard and seen as it had been told them. Thus saith the Lord. Amen.
Jesus, the Savior, was born for to die for poor, hungry people like you and like I. I wonder, as I wander out under the sky, when Mary birthed Jesus, 'twas in a cow stall, with wise men and farmers and cattle and all. But high from God's heaven a star's light did fall, and the promise of ages it then did recall. If Jesus had wanted for any wee thing, a star in the sky or a bird on the wing, or all of God's angels in heaven for to sing, he surely could have it, 'cause he was the King. I wonder, as I wander out under the sky, how Jesus the Savior was born for to die for poor, hungry people like you and like I. I wonder, as I wander out under the sky.
Thank you so much, Andrew. I first heard Andrew perform this piece at a Dartmouth choral concert. He came in with a cap on his head and wandered across the stage. It is so haunting and so beautiful. I wonder as I wander out under the sky why Jesus the Savior did come for to die for poor, ornery people like you and like I. I wonder as I wander out under the sky. Or often is some discussion on whether we are a people who basically have love and compassion in our hearts, or are there other times that we're ornery? And in 2016, I think that history will probably look back and say that we were slightly ornery. Misogynistic, the language that was used in the last year, and the racism that seems to be rampant. And yet, we come to this time for a place of hope. I came across this piece of art, and let's put it up and leave it up for the rest of the sermon. It's by Georgia O'Keeffe. It's called Black Cross with Stars. Now, Georgia O'Keeffe lived to be 98 years old, and she painted through most of those decades. In 1929, seeking solitude, O'Keeffe traveled to New Mexico, and for over 20 years, she spent the better part of every year working there, becoming increasingly interested in Southwest landscapes, where she eventually settled permanently and worked until her death at the age of 98. O'Keeffe recounts, "I saw the crosses so often, and often in unexpected places, like a thin dark veil of the Catholic Church spread over the New Mexican landscape." And as we gaze beyond the cross-shaped frame, we are invited to contemplate the art. We are invited to wonder as we wander in these vast spaces of this beautiful planet, this beautiful world. And we ponder the mystery of the incarnation on this night in particular, and how it has and should be transforming our world. And perhaps a wonder as we wander why it has to be this ongoing, continuous project. For me, this particular painting brings back memories of Christmas Eve services in my home church in Moncton, 11 p.m. service, and coming home and seeing the stars, and then in the horizon seeing the school that was just beside our home as I walked home, or seeing the trees and the outline in the dark sky, or the outline of Dad's heating fuel oil truck in the driveway. A stark but wonderful memory for me. You see, the cradle and the cross are two essential parts of the same story. And unfortunately, we haven't, as a church, done a very good job talking about how the two are interconnected. This fall, a group of us looked at violence in the Bible. And we looked at it through a different lens, John Dominic Crossan's lens. And in particular at the violence that is attributed to God in the Bible, in the name of God's justice and God's righteousness. The study was called Violence Divine, Overcoming the Bible's Portrayal of its nonviolent God. You see, our assumptions about how God seeks justice need to be challenged. God demands justice in most cases, and this is the bad theology that we've had through the years, is that God demands justice through substitutionary atonement. And that needs to be challenged because it is bad theology. To put it another way, it's like saying that Jesus takes on the punishment for all our sins that God requires. And that needs has caused a lot of harm and needs to be re-envisioned. Atonement shouldn't be thrown out, but it should be looked at more at one-ment, that sense of being connected and reconnected with our God, with the source of our lives. Now, Jesus does this very well in one of his most popular parables, and that's the parable of the prodigal son. Because if you look at the two sons, they have a lot of assumptions about how their father wants their world to be ordered and how God wants justice, how God wants to make sure that everything is all right. And yet, the two sons discover that their father will turn everything upside down in order to invite them to the party. Because you see, God's justice is about distributive justice, and that it is this God who is non-ambivalent, that is a preferential option for those who are poor and suffering, and non-violent, even to the point of death. And that's where the atonement comes in. God invites us to the party of transforming the world by connecting with that power. Jesus said, "I give you a new commandment, love one another. And you're to love one another the way that I have loved you. This is how all will know that you're my disciples, that you truly love one another." That we should love one another is not new. There have been many before Jesus and since Jesus who have come to offer this commandment, who have advised, encouraged, implored, and even begged us to love one another. But what is new in this commandment is that we are to love one another the way that Jesus loves us. Jesus was so open to the power of the love that is God that Jesus was able to live his life fully without fear, without shame, and without guilt. Jesus wanted more than anything else for his followers to be so open to the power of that love, so that they too would live their lives fully without fear, shame, or guilt. Jesus was so open to that power that Jesus would not let any powers of darkness stop him from loving and living fully. It's a kind of love that's incarnated, embodied in all that he did and all that he was. It had no boundaries, and there no darkness, no power, no fear. Not even death can limit the power of this love. For if love is limited by death, then love will always be qualified and quantified. Jesus is willing to live without these boundaries, and it came at great cost to himself. But he was willing to pay that price in order to show others the way, in order to save us, in order to free us, so that we could live without limit, without fear, without boundaries. And that whatever happens, whatever is thrown at us, whatever the world or evil can conjure up against us, does not make any difference because we have conquered that fear. That's why the cradle and the cross are interconnected. One cannot be understood without the other. And that is why when we talk about Jesus being born in our hearts and in the world, we are talking about the process of incarnation, of embodying that way. And this is a process of atonement or at-one-ment. Jesus has shown us the way. We are saved and freed to live abundantly. We are saved to live lives that are free from the fear of death, precisely because of the Jesus event. And we have been shown the way, a way to live fully, extravagantly, compassionately, and passionately, and to be all that we are created to be. And that when we talked about love shining in the darkness and darkness shall not overcome it, that's exactly the message of tonight. I don't know about you, but I need this love to be born once again in my heart tonight. And I guess And as I gaze out into the star-lit night that's in that horizon through the eyes of that cross, it offers me the hope of God's love that is transforming our lives and our world. I've adapted an affirmation of faith as a fitting way to conclude this message. When the Christ is born, we will be near. We will cherish this fragile life in faith. We will commit our lives to the opening of the doors of the world for the coming of love. We will commit our lives to incarnating that love. We will be those who kneel by the manger and carry with us hope, peace, joy, and love to a hungry people. For these are the gifts which Christ waits to receive. Thanks be to God for the coming of Christmas. Amen.
May we pray. We remember before you, O God, Mary and Joseph, and in the season of Christmas, all travelers. We remember before you the innkeeper, and in this season of Christmas, all those who are homeless or unwelcome. We remember before you, O Holy One, the shepherds and all those who work while we sleep, or whose efforts provide us food or warmth or health care or comfort or safety or freedom. We remember before you the Magi, and in this season of Christmas, all who bear gifts and all who teach us to wonder and worship and give thanks. We remember before you, O God, the angels and their message of peace and light and goodwill. We remember before you Herod, and in the season of Christmas, all those who are in positions of power, able to make decisions that affect the lives of many others. We remember before you, O God of mercy, the children of Bethlehem. And in this season of Christmas, all who are victims of violence or oppression or fear. We remember before you the Christ child, laid in a manger, and when he grew up, the sick who crowded around him, and in this season of Christmas, we remember all we know who come to him yet, Especially today, we pray for the ones who are in our hearts and others whom we know. In this season of Christmas, O God, may your presence be known in us and in what we do. Amen. And let us pray together the prayer Jesus taught us to say. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
And Pat is with us doing a yeoman service. Bad pun. But thank you so much, Pat. If Malcolm were here, what would he say? Do it again. Let's do the chorus again. Let us leave this place as those who have prepared a place for the coming of the Christ. in our hands, in our hearts, lies hope which may blossom forth in abundant and extravagant light. And may the melodies of peace hover over the world this night. The heralds of love speak into the hearts of all people, and the longing of creation for its Christ be fulfilled with the dawn. Amen.